All right then, so we are live. I'll wait a minute or two, then do the intro, and then we get going properly. As you can see, hopefully from the title, it's a live with Hans Schuss, their founder, and potentially with some other individuals from the team as well. I'm not sure about it. So yeah, let's wait a minute or two, set everything up. And then we can get going. I hope the internet connection stays stable, it doesn't act up, so we don't have any cutoffs or drops in the video quality. Let me set this one up. Alrighty, so I'll turn to the camera and here we go. Welcome everyone. If you already know me, well, then you already know me. If you don't, and if you're new to this channel, if you've just followed the channel because of that post, that was the announcement, or because of the YouTube video, hi, welcome to my Instagram. My name is Kais Hadzic. I'm a nutritional science student in my bachelor's degree, finishing it up, and a enthusiast when it comes to technical development in sports overall. I actually almost started studying sports science, kinesiology, and biomechanics was on the brink as well. And I'm very fascinated by all the things that happen in our world when it comes to technological advances, when it comes to sports. I'm an ex-high-level competitive swimmer, and I mentioned this in the YouTube announcement that I did, which is arguably swimming was the first sport that kind of reintroduced this idea of technical or mechanical doping in the modern era with the suits that were made specifically for the Beijing 2008 Olympics, made by Speedo, a swimwear brand, in conjunction with NASA, where they developed a special suit with a polyurethane, so basically a plastic coating, that made the swimmers very fast, very buoyant, and pretty much the suit, arguably on itself, broke all the records. And then it became very controversial because people were making the argument, obviously, that the suit is doing all the swimming. Obviously, it wasn't, but it was still giving a massive advantage until the suits were banned in 2009. The last event was Roma, 2009. I think it was a FINA either cup or a world championship, and pretty much everyone went all out, developed the most techie suits they could possibly do. Arena also entered the market, another swimwear brand, which arguably made an even better suit, which is completely made of polyurethane, so it was basically just plastic. And the funny thing about that was that it pretty much took a team of people to get you into the suit because they were so tight and so unstretchy, yet gave you such a massive advantage. I'm not sure if any of the records actually still stand from that era, which goes to show that, well, everyone who was swimming in that era got pretty much demolished by today's swimmers, not necessarily by the technology, but more so by the advancements in training. A year ago, we had the sub 2-hour marathon in Vienna, where I was just until yesterday, and where Eliud Kipchoge broke the 2-hour barrier, which was this mythical barrier that was proposed that no one could beat. And if they were able to run under 2 hours, they would have massive consequences when it comes to their health and whatever. And that also brought up another point, and also brought mechanical doping back into the picture with the introduction of the AlphaFly, the shoe Eliud ran in, which at the time was believed to have 3 carbon plates, which was like arguably like a very like a spring basically, and whatnot. So I'm very fascinated by these things, and generally fascinated by the premise of technology pushing the human to its limit, and not necessarily we as a human species evolving all that much. That argument can be made in the 100-meter sprint as well. If you look at the world records, you could argue that the world record has improved mainly because of the surface, mainly because of the spikes and everything else, and not necessarily because the athletes, as athletes themselves, got more or better, or I should say as humans. Obviously, the athlete got better due to better nutrition, better understanding of training regimens, and so on and so forth. But long story short, I ran across the post from Hans Schuss, which was proposing this idea of a carbon fiber-based cushioning system, or a suspension system, if you will. And I approached them if they would like to share more information on that, because they're also going live with a Kickstarter campaign. And my first question was regarding the variability, if the shoe could be adjusted to different weight classes, because that would be something interesting to me personally, because I'm quite heavy for a runner. Well, I'm not a runner right up front. And I approached them. They were so kind to give me this opportunity to talk to them. And I'll be pulling them live in just a second, but before we get on live with the founder, Alain, just a quick disclosure. Obviously, I'm not getting paid for this. I would not want to get paid for this. I approached them, as I said, and I'm not looking at this like I'm doing them any favors. Like I said, I'm very appreciative that they gave me this opportunity, and I'm very excited to talk to the founder and learn more about this product. So let's pull them up and let's send them a request. Request is sent. Oh, hello there.
Hey there.
Good evening. Hopefully you've made the introduction and you've seen it. As I said, my name is Kais. Please do introduce yourself, your name, your company, and everything else, just the final details so we know. And I know who I'm talking to, because this is the first time we see each other and we basically meet.
Yeah, thank you, Kaj. I really appreciate the opportunity to be on with you on your Instagram. My name is Len Han, H-A-N-N, and I'm the founder of Han Shoes. A little background, I'm an engineer. In my earlier life, I was a telecommunications engineer doing cellular work and long distance telephony. But I've always been an athlete. I've always been an adventure sports person. I learned to fly in high school, started ski racing in college and did that for 12 years and got to a fairly high level, and also started skydiving in college, that for 20 years. And then in the running side of things, I'd always dabbled in running. I've always been a bicyclist and a runner. Had this goal of running a marathon, and finally did in 95 after having tried for the previous decade. So finally completed a marathon, but in the process of completing a marathon, you know, ran across a bunch of interesting observations about the technology.
All right. So it's a very, very interesting career, and you're a lifetime athlete, which is good to see, good to know that also the older generations, there are some lifetime athletes. I'm obviously a lot younger, but I would consider myself a lifetime athlete as well. It's always nice to encounter these stories. So how big is your team? If you're comfortable in sharing these details, what was the main inspiration for the shoe? You talked that you had many influences over the years, especially in preparation for the marathon. So how did you come to this idea of making a new cushioning system for a running shoe?
Okay, so that was a series of happy accidents, if you will. I used to travel a lot for work, and doing all of this running and doing all this bicycling. And if you're a bikie, you know, if you're into road biking, you're a total gearhead, okay? Because every little improvement in frame and wheel and all of that leads to a perceptible improvement, in what you're in the results you're getting. And in my whole life, I've always been about the experience. To elaborate on that, you know, if you're riding a soggy mountain bike with fat tires that are a little low on air, you know, it's a slog, okay? But you hop onto your, you know, 110 PSI road bike, and, you know, every pedal, you can feel every pedal stroke just thrusting you forward, you know, and every half inch you drop lower, you know, you're going a little bit faster. And so the experience, and you know, we haven't even gotten into skydiving, you know, the experience of, you know, normal face to earth and then going inverted and rocketing, you know, up to a much higher speed. You know, you can gain 80 miles an hour that way. So the experience drives, I think, in a big way, all of our quality of life. Okay. And And so I was traveling a lot for work, back to that. And O'Hare Airport in Chicago used to have a moving sidewalk, a moving sidewalk belt made by Dunlop that was just, and they've replaced it since then with the mechanic, you know, with the metal plate kind of moving sidewalk. But it was a remarkable thing because you stand on that thing and it was very much like a trampoline, except instead of a recreational trampoline, you know, which has a lot of suspension travel, this thing only had, you know, only had 6-7 centimeters, okay, of suspension travel. It was very taut. And I ended up talking with the guys who worked on the thing. It was only about as thick as your thumb, the belt, and it was tensioned to 3,000 pounds, which is quite taut. And so I would go through there to and from the underground parking all the time. And every now and then I would lay all my bags and luggage down, and I would actually, you know, take my shoes off and run on the belt. Well, one evening back, you know, decades ago now, one evening I had this sort of idea, and I dressed for a long run and grabbed my Gatorade and a few snacks and went to O'Hare. And as it turns out, that evening the belts were all shut off, all five of them, okay, were all shut off. And no one was there. You know, there were a couple workers, and I said, can I run on these belts? And they were like, rock your socks off, you know, have fun. And I ran for 2 hours. I ran a half marathon on the belts barefoot. I took my shoes off and ran barefoot. And to say that that left an impression would be an understatement. It's driven the last 20 years of my life. My pace on that belt was effortless. It was like I was running downhill the whole way. Every time I turned around at the end and came back, it felt like the whole thing was downhill. And it wasn't just that, it was the nature of the surface in the way that it was easy on my muscles, was easy on my legs. Okay. It was remarkable. And I decided then and there, I'd already run a couple marathons at that point. And I decided then and there that I had to somehow come up with a shoe that could duplicate that. Here we are.
That's actually a very fascinating story. And it's quite interesting how kind of random events you came into the plane and they were kind of immediately shut down, where anything can inspire so many things. So you mentioned that you were developing this idea for the past 20 years. So what were some of the challenges you encountered generally in the development of shoes as well? And what were some challenges that you encountered specifically with your product that you're trying to create?
Well, okay, so it was the work was broken up into three phases. There was an initial chunk of biomechanical research. And this is, you know, working at Bell Labs at the time, which became Lucent. I had a pre-internet email address. I had an ARPANET email address. And you could find a little bit of research material there, but not much. So I had to go visit big medical libraries, you know, and write to people, you know, on paper and stamps, you know. I had to write to people and get them to send me their research papers for biomechanics. And what I found, and there's a lot to go into, but what I found, there was one researcher in particular, a Dr. Ben O'Nig, up at the University of Calgary. He's Swiss or Austrian, I think, Dr. Nig. And he had this paper on something called muscle tuning. Muscle tuning, what it is, it's very simple, actually. What it is, have you ever gone off of a step in your house and thought you were on the very bottom step, but you weren't, you were one step high, and you've gone off that step in the dark, and you're like, ah, you know, you scare yourself, you slam down on the ground. But if you were to hop off that same step in the daytime, right, where you could see, it would be no big deal. You wouldn't even notice it. You'd hop right off and you'd keep going. What was the difference, right? What was the difference? The difference was you weren't aware of the impending crash you were about to take, and your muscles weren't ready for it in the sense that they had not pre-tensioned themselves for the landing. Okay? You know, if you've ever skied in really whiteout conditions, you know, you get a feel for the terrain and you're like, you know, you're descending and descending and turning, but every now and then if you hit a terrain change, all of a sudden you get the little swoop and then bam, you know. And you know, hopefully you stay up, right? But it was something you couldn't see and therefore you couldn't anticipate. Well, so what Dr. Nigg called this anticipation of the terrain that you were about to step into, he called that muscle tuning, this pre-tensioning. And like everything in life, in engineering, there's a cost. There's no free lunch, right? The muscle tuning, which you do every day, you do with every step you take, even the smallest, you know, babies do it and marathon elite runners do it. Everyone does it. The muscle tuning exerts a cost, both in terms of oxygen, but also muscular glycogen.
Okay, so very interesting. And the thing I wanted to talk about.
You're talking about three phases. That was three phases. The first phase was the research phase. Then the second phase was trying to come up with something that I could put onto a shoe that would accomplish this. And I went through dozens of iterations. Here's something no one's ever seen. Nobody's ever seen this.
Getting an exclusive.
Yeah. I threw away a lot of prototypes. They were just disgusting. But this one was actually kind of cool. Look at this. It's an air. It's a sewn up one of the parachute riggers. And see, there's the bike valve. Okay, one of the parachute riggers helped me design and sew this up, and I put it on a shoe and I ran a 10K with it. I ran a 10K with it, and it was really pretty good. You know, but it's heavy.
Yeah.
It's heavy and it's very sensitive to the air pressure. I mean, like to the half pound, right? But it was a useful step in the right direction. And so that was high volume air, okay? And there's some ideas why you should go to high volume air. And high volume air is a good thing, okay? If you can do it right. But it wasn't enough, okay? And you know, right now the state of the art is the like the Vaporfly. You know, it's a carbon plate with a really high resiliency foam. Okay. But the problem with foam and any material, I mean, if I could cut a cube of air and have it stay intact, you know, if I could cut that and have it stay intact and you know, carve it, cut it to fit a midsole of a shoe, if I could do that, it wouldn't be a good shoe. You would think it would be great because, you know, well, you've got that compression, right? But the problem with materials, with a material, any material, is that it's homogeneous in its properties all the way around. And so when you put weight on it, okay, when you put weight on it, it wants to roll off, forward, back, kind of like, I don't know, Jell-O. Think about Jell-O, the dessert, okay? You know, you put pressure on that and it goes every direction. So does your outsole. So does your midsole, pardon me. And like the Hoka shoes, okay? They're lovely shoes. They're my favorite foam shoes right now. The reason that outsole is so large, like a small snowshoe, is to try to minimize that rolling tendency, to try to give you a firmer center to sit in. Does that make sense?
It definitely does. And I think everyone can agree, if they ran in a shoe that was a bit of a narrow platform, they very likely struggled with just the stability aspect and feeling comfortable, especially on the longer run. Like for me, I'm roughly 210 pounds. And like I said, I'm not a runner by any stretch of the imagination. I had a brief period where I was running, when I was transitioning from swimming into weightlifting. And in that period, I was a bit lighter, but not much. Like I said, 210 pounds right about now. And one of the main problems I have with any foam is the foam breaking down at a very rapid pace for me. Obviously, that foam is designed for the typical runner, if you will, who weighs 160 pounds, maybe even lighter. And that was the first idea I actually came up with, I guess, when I saw your post and when I commented it. Would it even be possible for your concept to be adapted, if you will, for weight classes? So I'm guessing the flexibility would be different, the stiffness would be different for different weight classes. And I propose that could also be like a marketing tactic that you could push that would be unique, a unique selling point for the shoe itself.
Exactly. You're spot on. You could be a shoe designer.
Appreciate it.
Yeah. Oh, really? Because okay. So this was another. We had a couple of really good influential scientists who helped us with this program. Dr. Ben Onig, you know, helped us with this. Dr. Michael Leahy, who is the inventor of ART, active release technique, the leading soft tissue therapy. Okay. And Dr. Leahy has done 45 Ironman races himself. You know, the guy's an animal. And really good at assessing what's working in a shoe. You know, he was our expert wear tester at one point. And so one of the things that Dr. Nig came up with was, you know, as people started building neutral motion control and stability shoes, okay? They did studies on, are these things reducing rates of injury? And if people are going to build them, neutral motion control stability shoes, if people are going to build them, you would think they would reduce rates of injury, right? You would think, okay, they didn't.
Okay.
They didn't. They don't. And so, you know, Dr. Nig said that, you know, you should analyze every problem to be as simple as possible, but not simpler. Okay. That it needs to be. And by that, what he meant was, you know, the gait of a runner, the biomechanics of a runner over the terrain are exceedingly complex. And something so simple as a motion control shoe to try to reduce pronation, you know, doesn't help. Okay, so our shoe, here we go. Here's our shoe. Okay, and you see the ellipses. Okay, people say, well, is it a neutral or a motion control shoe or a stability shoe? And it's like, it's all of those and none of those. It's a full, you know, for lack of an existing term, there is no existing term, it's a full suspension shoe, okay? And in being a full suspension shoe, which compared to all previous footwear, okay, foam doesn't exhibit suspension for two reasons. It's the travel is too tiny to be useful. And it's also exceedingly nonlinear. You know, it's foam is soft, soft, hard. And remember that going off the stair, how that hurt you, you know? Well, imagine doing that tiny stair every time, you know, you 800 times in a mile, what the energy cost of that would be and the physical toll on your body, right? That's why the minimalist shoe movement really kind of caught hold for a while. You know, the Born to Run book and the Tarahumara Indians and all that. But the problem with minimalist shoes is that no one's got the biomechanics for it, and they don't have the body. You know, anyone who's higher BMI, you know, I'm 167 pounds, okay? But I've got a relatively high, like 25 BMI, okay? And so if you're an athlete, you're going to have a high BMI. It's just the way it is. And so what I determined, you know, all that research phase, what I determined is that, and then the experience of running on that belt, what I determined, and then confirming all of that with the experts, was that suspension travel in a shoe properly applied and sequenced, okay, because when, it, you know, in sequenced, could not only take the sharp edges, the sharp spikes of the ground reaction force, which occurs in two places. It occurs on heel in. That's what everyone thinks of. Oh, when your heel lands, that's the big spike of energy. Yeah, but not really. The more important one is in the forefoot. Okay? The forefoot is key to all future breakthroughs in footwear. It really is, because that's where, and all these shoes that have something clever in the heel, you know, but nothing, just foam in the forefoot, it's like you've created a little trampoline or possibly some sort of an energy recovery system for the heel, and then bam, you know, if someone jumps off the other end of the teeter totter, you go slamming onto your can, right? Well, that's your forefoot with every step when you've got something that's got a nice compliant heel. The forefoot smacks into the ground. So you need both. You need energy absorption and release in the heel. And the problem with foam, okay, all foams, is that even the high-end foams used by Nike and others, okay, aside from that stability problem because of the material wanting to act uniformly in all directions, aside from that, they have a damping coefficient. All foams are damping. And if you think about running across a field that's muddy, you know, you can do it, but you're not going to be fast. Well, that's foam on your feet. Foam is like running through mud. You know, when people talk about, oh, this shoe's more lively than the previous shoe. And it's like, well, that's great. And if it feels good for you, run in it. But the suspension, okay, is shockingly reactive, is shockingly energetic. And so to drill right down to your question, it seems to have a pretty large envelope, a given suspension rate for people all the way down to 110 pounds, all the way up to 210 pounds, okay? But you're right, there would be an ideal suspension rate for every weight class of runner. And right now we're considering, there are several ways of boosting the rate on this. We're considering offering options for higher BMI runners. The best one would be to offer an entire upgraded suspension, you know, for any given size of shoe for men or women. The ultimate answer would be to offer two tiers of suspension, you know, your standard rate and your high BMI rate. But there are ways of boosting the suspension as well, and we're considering those too.
Actually, I think that would feel like a very specific market that isn't really addressed by the running industry, if you will. Like people who are more athletic, who do it as a way of just having some additional activity, having some variety in their training, say CrossFitters, for example, higher level athletes, as we already agreed, that have higher BMIs. My BMI is right around, I think, 27 something, and I'm at roughly 10% body fat. So I'm not fat, if you will. I'm just heavy because I'm carrying that extra muscle mass that's going to punish me during those longer runs because of the impact mainly. And I think that would really fill a niche market that isn't really a niche and make a lot of people happy. But with that being said, the two you currently have with you that you're showing us, what are we looking at? Is it a prototype, a pre-production model, a pre-serial model, a serial model? How far in development are you, and what are the goals with the shoe for how long?
Okay, this is one of two pairs in the country right now. We only have two pairs of these. And it's a pre-production model. It's the first out of the factory that uses our highly designed anatomic last, okay? And there's a reason for that. And it's got, you know, close to production suspension elements and pretty much a close to production upper. We're gonna change the colors a little bit, but it's close. It's work, you know, it's good. It's a reasonable, it's better than any of our previous samples. And so what we're planning to do with this is launch the Kickstarter on January 25th, I believe, and sell as many pairs, you know, within, I don't even know, really know what a practical upper limit is, because we're working with a good brand. We're working with a good factory to build the shoes. I think we have a fairly good capacity there. So if we can get enough of the composites done correctly on time, we could build a lot of shoes. And so during the Kickstarter, we hope to sell a bunch of shoes and then get them out there onto people's feet. And here's why. Here's why. The very first time I ever ran this shoe, a version of this shoe, in 2002, Chicago Marathon, I had done 9 previous marathons, and my time my PR in 9 previous marathons was 4:38. Okay. And that, which is mid pack, you know, but for 17 years, I was the pace leader for the 10-minute group for Chicago Area Runners Association, CARA. So I taught hundreds and hundreds of marathoners how to run marathons, you know? And so the training was very consistent, you know, all those years. And, you know, the mileage and the experience was very consistent. And my PR was 4:38. When I put this shoe on and ran in 2002, my first half was, you know, was just a little bit over 2 hours. And I was kind of holding it back. And so I thought, well, you know, we're at the halfway point. Let's pick it up a little bit. In that marathon, I ran a negative split. The second half faster than the first, which is hard for a recreational runner. You know, the elites do that, but I don't. And the last mile was the fastest mile of all. So I left gas on the table. I could have gone quicker. And my time was 4:23. I cut 15 minutes off, which was 6%. And we've had other people run long distances, and some of their testimonials are on our website, and they've had the same sorts of results. So to talk about the good time or the better time, you know, the PR time, that's one thing, but the experience of it, you know, if you're running a crowded marathon, Chicago is 45,000 people now, right? If you're and you're mid-pack, you're not in the first wave or anything, you know, you're mid-pack. And so if you're running a crowded marathon, it's a real pain to have to cut through traffic laterally. Okay. What you want to do is what you do on the road when you're driving. You want to cut through traffic going forward diagonally. You know, you want to cut through traffic that way. It's smoother and easier. I was able to through the whole marathon, and at the end, it was just, you know, holy cow, this is a peak experience. And if I could give that experience to, you know, tens of thousands of other runners, it would change their lives, just like it changed mine.
And this perfectly segues into the next point I wanted to address, which is some of the numbers you have on your website, as already mentioned. One of the numbers was 6%. When running a marathon, running 0.6 miles less, if you will. And the other number you pointed out was double the durability of traditional foams, right? Which is something I would be definitely interested in. Like, I don't think I'll ever run a marathon. If I'll probably survive it in some way. But as someone who likes to run, but is giving out way too much money on way too many pairs of shoes because they're tearing after a month or two, and like 100 miles maybe, that would be something I would definitely look forward to. So, where does the number of double the durability come from? Is it also from real life testing or from lab tests as well?
No, from actual live testing. I have one pair of earlier prototypes that I myself, with a logbook, put over 800 miles on. You know, and they look pretty ratty now. I tell people, you know, who are running in these shoes, and we'll probably put a space on the website for the highest mileage shoes, you know, the people who've got 1,000 miles plus on their shoes. Just like Volvo used to do, you know, with their million-mile cars, right? But it would change the whole running shoe industry, you know, to not have them be worthless at 400 miles or less, 300 miles. And if you can use shoe goo, okay, that thick honey-like urethane, right? If you learn how to clean the shoes and put the tape on and squirt on the shoe goo and smooth it out and then leave it for 24 hours or more. That you've effectively resold your shoes. And I had to do that with an earlier pair of these, because, you know, that we would wear through the outsole, but by putting on the shoe goo, I got 800 miles out of them. And then the uppers tore out.
Okay, when the upper wears out, you definitely know that your cushioning is splitting up. So yeah, that's definitely something. So let's do some comparisons with your future competitors, I hope. We already mentioned the Vaporfly, the Alphafly, which at some point, especially when doing, going about the INEOS 159 challenge, arguably had 3 plates, but it turned out it only had 1 plate. Correct me if I'm wrong, but that shoe is relying on two main aspects. The rebound of the foam itself, and the rebound as well as the tip off of the plate because of its curvature. So it's technically, well, pushing you forward away, not necessarily giving back energy to the majority of the extent, whereas this suspension system, cushioning system, would basically take all the energy and give most of it directly back into the leg of the runner.
Well, so, okay, I have to be a little bit careful when I talk about the Vaporfly and the Alphafly shoes. And then there's a bunch of plate and foam, you know, similar shoes out there from other brands, Hoka and Saucony and Brooks and what have you. If they are getting the times they're getting, they've got to be reducing systemic oxygen consumption. They have to be. It's just, you know, that's how that works. As to the mechanism that they're, you know, how they're doing it, I can really only speculate. I've run in Vaporfly shoes personally, and you know, if you've ever run around or walked in a bike shoe, a bicycling shoe, like a cleatless bike shoe, the soles of those things are very stiff, of those shoes. And I was running in those and on level ground and thought, these really aren't doing it for me. I'm too slow. I need to be like a sub 6 minute guy to get the good stuff out of these shoes, right? And then I turned and went up a fairly steep hill, and going up the hill is kind of like, you know, picking up your pace in terms of your relationship to the ground, okay? And I can start to feel it's like, okay, that's what they're doing. You know, the plate, the rocker in the plate, you know, is kind of reacting with my gait to help ease me into the next stride, I think. But I don't think that's going to help me at my pace, you know, in regular life. Plus, those foams are very delicate. You know, the knock on those shoes is that they cost $250, and that's how many miles you get. You know, now the suspension, if you just look at somebody standing still, the suspension is constantly moving. Okay, even when you're standing still, And so it's absorbing and returning energy to your muscles, to your large muscle groups, even when you're standing still. Okay. And that's muscular flex, you know, like micro flexing that you don't have to do if the shoe's doing, you know, to maintain your balance and move you around. So, you know, those are some great shoes, but that's not really who I see as our competitor. You know, honestly, I don't think we have a competitor. I mean, our competitor is regular running shoes, regular running trainers, you know, that people wear everywhere, just doing their daily lives. And for those people, see, one of the things that I saw teaching marathoners how to run for 17 years, okay, I saw a lot of people come in, you know, with this bright-eyed, big ambition, I'm going to run a marathon, woo, you know, who were really kind of overweight. And for those people, for some of them, I said, look, you know, let's get you a bike, let's get you an elliptical trainer, let's get you a rowing machine, and you can still do the running, but do far more volume on the rowing machine at first, you know? And the reason is that running in foam shoes is punishing. It's punishing on your body. It's hard. You know, you really have to be naturally good with the biomechanics of your gait, and you have to really pay attention, you know, to the experience, to the, you know, I would always tell people, you do not run with headphones in my group. And they're like, but we love our headphones, you know? And it's like, yeah, but your knees don't, you know? And it's easy. You know, I got a horrible injury doing 17 miles on a treadmill once, just because the gait was so perfectly similar on that treadmill. And I think it was like a piriformis muscle that was just like, you know, had a hot knife on it. It was wicked. And so one of the things I discovered in teaching people how to run marathons is that overweight, in my opinion, just my opinion, okay, is caused less by diet than it is by activity level. You know, and if we could make the experience of getting out and walking around the block, getting out and maybe jogging a little bit, if we could make that experience a level of magnitude more enjoyable, more embraceable, imagine what that would do for everyone's health. It would revolutionize everything. So that's what we're up to.
Definitely. And the one thing I really like that you explained is the experience. And also, if you will, getting into the flow and getting really settled into a specific pace where you run and everything feels perfect. For me, it's very rare. At those times, I really enjoy running, and that doesn't happen very often. And usually, even though I like to go and run, I know I'm not going to enjoy it. And when that happens, when I get into that specific mood and specific flow, I really feel amazing. And if that shoe can give that experience to everyone, that would definitely be a selling point for every single person, at least from my point of view. The second thing I really enjoy is that you are saying that you're not competing with Nike, with Hoka, with Saucony, with Adidas, and every other brand with the carbon plates. One other shoe that aesthetically, I would say, looks closest to your shoe that you have is the Mizuno Wave Prophecy. Correct me if I'm wrong, they were trying something similar. I'm not sure if that shoe is in their running catalog. I think the last model was the 9th generation of the shoe, but he also has some kind of plate. I think it's either TPU or polyurethane and something in the sandwich in between, and then another layer of the zigzag plastic, whatever. So is that something that we could look and experience, and at least have an idea what your shoe could offer us?
No.
Okay, right off the bat.
No, And here's why. Here's why. It's really simple. It's really simple. The carbon fiber in our suspension elements is, you know, aerospace grade, toughened epoxy, the best. Okay. And when you jump on it, you can barely move them with your hands. Okay. And when you jump on it, however, you know, you get good resilient suspension, with no damping. It's very linear and it's very responsive. Okay. Low hysteresis is the word. It's very low hysteresis. Okay. All the Mizuno shoes, and they're cool. I love them. I'm not a personal fan, but they are interesting. Okay. All those plates are made out of PVAX, nylon, or possibly TPU, dense, you know, material. And if you wouldn't take that material and make a golf club shaft out of it, okay, and which you wouldn't do that with nylon, it would be useless, right? But carbon fiber, that's every golf club shaft there is now, right? So if you wouldn't put that material into a golf club shaft, it shouldn't be in an energy management shoe. And so no, Mizuno, you know, Mizuno, if they were to develop that line of thinking for years and years more, this is where they would end up.
So say you enter Kickstarter, you get to your goal, and we're talking ideal case scenario, 5 years down the road, or even shorter or longer, who knows? We can't predict the future. Your shoe gets onto the mainstream market, and we see potentially the shoe getting introduced into the broader audience. Would it potentially be approved by the Athletics Commission? Because we know that now with their ruling, they're very strict with the max heights. I'm not sure if they have any numbers on the max energy returns or whatever. I'm not very familiar with their testing, but I know back in the day when they did it with swimming, basically when they banned the full body suits, you set very strict rules. It could only be natural materials. The permeability had to be at least 50%. For men, it could only cover the portion from the belly to the knee, and so on and so forth. So would it be possible for your shoe to be potentially seen in a marathon 10 years from now at the Olympics?
Okay, so the phrase mechanical doping is popular right now. And, you know, that charge is levied against the Nike shoes. For them to be reducing systemic oxygen consumption, which is extremely difficult. Our shoe was measured by Dr. Ben O'Neig at the University of Calgary Human Performance Lab. You know, measuring gas in, gas out, a whole line of runners on treadmills, okay, running the shoe, measuring actual oxygen consumption. And at that time, we were shown to be 2.2% less systemic oxygen consumption than a high-end New Balance shoe at the time. They have to be reducing systemic O2 as well. I don't know by how much. You know, for me, I cut 6% off of a marathon time. I think they're advertising some of their latest shoes as being 6%. So they might be somewhere in the same ballpark. I don't know. But the notion that a technological advance should be banned really has to look at two things. The increased performance of our shoe is a side effect. The main effect is fatigue and injury reduction. Fatigue and injury reduction. If you look at the ground reaction force curve, we're taking off the tall spikes, the sharp overshoots of energy that cause stress fractures. And this is my opinion. We haven't proved this in a lab yet. We haven't done EMG testing. You know, I haven't let anyone put electrode needles in my quad yet. Someone will sooner or later. But my conjecture is that by taking off, we have measured ground reaction force, and by taking off those sharp peaks, we've got lots of anecdotal reporting that people's chronic injuries are being relieved, and we've got some testimonials on our website from people with severe back pain that have had it go away. And so, you know, you get that hammer and chisel and stop it, you know, from hammering straight up your back, you're going to have less chronic pain. And that's what we're really working towards here. The performance is a spinoff. Okay. In fact, when we were talking about basketball versions of this shoe, it wasn't anything about jump higher. No, it was about stay above the rim in the fourth quarter, you know, increased endurance. Okay. And it's the same with this shoe. You know, you might be going faster since you're burning less systemic O2. You can now go faster if you want to, or you can have more endurance or some combination, whatever you want, however you want to dial it in. Right. But hitting the end of the marathon without, you know, bonking is a huge experience for a mid-pack person. You know, it's like, I feel like one of the elites, you know, where's my confetti parade here? That's what we're going for. And when you look at kids, okay, bone growth plates, things like that, I've talked with moms who've had kids who damaged their bone growth plates trying to run too much volume for their age. Okay. Well, if we had these out there in kids' sizes now, I don't think, and again, my conjecture, I don't think that would be happening to their bone growth plates. So why would you ban that? You know, it's good for everybody. Now, here's the other answer. Who cares? Who cares? I mean, everything that's good now was banned at one time. Oversized head tennis rackets were banned. Oversized head golf drivers were banned. Now you can't buy anything that's not an oversized head tennis racket or golf driver. Hourglass skis were originally banned. Now they're all hourglass skis. You know, technology does what it does. If it brings benefits, it's gonna be adopted.
And also, that's something I didn't really expect, but I like. It's more so concentrated towards the average consumer than towards pro athlete. And we all know that's definitely a bigger market for everyone, regardless of company and regardless of technology, regardless of niche, whatever you want to call it. So, and again, my point of view from that, if I may add to it, is if we just look at simply at Newton's third law, you're not getting extra energy out of the shoe, so why should it be banned? If it increases efficiency, that's another thing. Whereas back in the swimming days, the suit were literally making you very buoyant, like you could not achieve naturally. And I personally was also against that. They were to be taking thick neoprene strips and putting them on the backs of the suits, where the swimmer was basically floating, not even floating. He was basically so high that he was swimming above the water, not in the water, and therefore creating something that can be achieved naturally. Arguably, this can. Arguably, someone could technically be so biomechanically efficient that they run even better without shoes. Some Kenyans are already doing, some Ethiopians are already doing, because they're poor and not these picking chosen athletes that get sponsored by Nike and all these big brands. So I don't see it being banned, but you made a great point. If it gets banned, who cares? That's not your primary market, and I love that.
It's, you know, if it helps people, if it gets them out of the house, right? If it gets them going around the block, if it gets them building new habits, okay? If it gets them joining a running group, even a little neighborhood running group, you know, and whatever pace they're going to, it's going to improve their lives. And for the age groupers out there, the age group competitors, okay, if they can hit times that they hit 10, 15 years ago, well, you know, happy day for them too, right? you know, because you can extend your career. And no kidding, having run at this point 21 marathons and a lot of training, I've gotten shorter. I have gotten shorter by like 3/4 of an inch. And that's you know, that's the toll. But I have no idea. I have no idea how it would work. But if I'd run my whole career on these, you know, maybe I would be the same as I used to be. I don't know. But you know, you see the pain that people get from being upright, you know, and just, you know, all the way down the chain, you know, from ankles to knees to hips to low back. That's a big cost in terms of quality of life and in terms of income for a lot of people. And you know, chronic pain is one of the worst things to have to live with. And we've had a lot of people wear our shoes and talk about how their chronic pain is diminished, you know? So even if it's not me, it doesn't have to be me, although it'd be nice if it was me. But, you know, it took a while for tri bikes to become, you know, we started with a pair of clip-on bars, right? That was where Dave Scott started it with clip-on bars. And now you look at like you look at a high-end Cervelo, you know, P7 or whatever, and it looks like a praying mantis. It's so angular and otherworldly, right? But there's no putting the genie back in the bottle. It's out, and that's the most efficient way to go fast on a bike. I contend that even if it's not me, you know, this suspension, okay, with the hinge, is going to define, you know, performance footwear going forward. I just, you know, it's the way engineering works. It's a better solution all the way around.
And actually, I think that's the perfect way to bring it to a close. I personally don't have any questions anymore. I love the parallel to the tri bikes. It's actually a perfect analogy. It had to start somewhere. It was very rudimentary. And one could argue that foams are still very rudimentary because we've been using them ever since we started making running shoes. And a lot of big technology is the carbon plate. And now we're potentially in your shoe with the full-on suspension system, where we're going to have a new way of cushioning and a new way of energy return and a new way of thinking about running shoes in general. So if you have anything you would like to add, share the details about your website, details about the Kickstarter campaign, where people can find you, and everything else, so people know where to look out for more information on your product and where they can just follow the development.
Okay, thanks. Thank you so much for having me on. I really feel grateful to have the opportunity to get the word out finally. I've been working on this shoe for a couple decades. You know, I used to look young with good hair like you, honestly. It's handshoes.com. The Kickstarter goes live on the 25th. I hope, I don't know if we're gonna, you know, it's our first shot at this, but I hope we sell enough orders, you know, tens of thousands, right? To be able to make a good splash when all those shoes get delivered, so that everyone can, you know, discover how good this thing is to run in, okay, and to walk in and to work in. That's what we're about. That's our company. It's, you know, at this point, it's my life's work, believe it or not. Thank you so much.
And your passion truly comes up. And I'm not a person who's usually like moved by these kind of things. And like I said, I approached you and really enjoyed it, and I'm the one who has to thank for you joining me and sharing this information out there. And I really hope that this is the next step that we will see your product succeed. And also, if I may suggest, for the future, if you're going to continue with this, obviously you're launching your Kickstarter campaign on January 25th, if I recall correctly. One quick suggestion, if you are able to potentially send a pair out to someone who's in the running community on YouTube or anyone else, that would definitely be great marketing, because I know, especially my generation, I'm 23, so early 20s, late 20s, 30s, people are going to be very influential. Not me particularly, but some of my viewers are definitely going to look at their favorite YouTuber, review this product, enjoy this product. And if you're so sure, and I'm currently sure of your product, I'm fascinated by it. I'm definitely sure that they're going to enjoy it and that they're going to talk about it and that you're going to get extra exposure that you definitely deserve, and that this product can be on the market and available to the general public as soon as possible.
Thanks so much. I'm really glad to be here.
And thank you for joining me. I'll call it a day, and I hope to be talking to you in the future, maybe even privately, or maybe even potentially doing more of this kind of stuff, because I would love to cover this, let's say, story, even though I'm not really someone who has a great all that big of a reach on YouTube was on Instagram. I would love to do my part in offering you something if I can, because I really believe in this, and this is really something that fascinates me.
Thank you so much. I'm sure when we get more of these, we can, you know, we'll do our best to get a pair into your hands.
I'd really appreciate it.
You're about 210 or so, you said?
Roughly 210, 6 foot.
So it would be helpful to actually, you know, do some testing with that weight class to find out if the way we intend to deliver these is working. So we'll let you know.
I'd really appreciate it. And as I said, I'm looking forward to talking to you. Again, everyone, thanks for joining. If you have any questions, the website mentalmoves.com. You're also on YouTube with the testimonials. I would look forward to seeing some content from there as well. The Kickstarter starts on January 25th. And I would like to thank everyone for watching and everyone for listening. Thank you, Len, for joining me. And hopefully we'll talk soon.
Thank you all very much. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.